Greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for choosing to worship with us in the next hour. We know that we are separated by place, by space, but we're united in Christ, in the Spirit, and we're united right now in worshiping God. So whether you are alone or you are in a small group, whether you are far away from where we are, the studio, or whether you are just around the corner, I invite you to come together to worship with us. Today we are going to be brought before the throne of God by uplifting Jesus through songs led by Paulette, Amanda, and Sheldon on the keyboard, on the piano. And we will be listening to an inspiring sermon from our pastor, Dan Smith. We know the world is in trouble, but in Christ, we have everything. And in Christ, we are going to expect the best there will ever be. My name is Wesley Toh, and I invite you today to worship with us, the LLBN family. Thank you.
As we start our worship time together, we invite you to join us in singing "Burdens Are Lifted at Calvary."
Can heal the spirit. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be in the same space and breathe the same air as other believers. We thank you, Lord, for being the absolute best, for being the one that we could turn to, for being the one that took all of our sin, for being the one to love us all infinitely. We cannot fathom the amount of love that you have for us, but we are so, so very grateful, especially in this season. Help us, O Lord, to open up our minds as we listen to the Word of God through Pastor Dan, and help us to enjoy this beautiful time. In your name we pray. Amen.
Earlier this week, that is on November 15, the population of planet Earth crossed the estimated 8 billion. Yes, you heard me correct, 8 billion. It might seem a bit crowded, but I have good news for you. The God of the universe, the creator of mankind and planet Earth, loved this world so much that he sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us on Calvary, so that whoever believes in him will have his sins forgiven and can have the assurance of eternal life. This is the best news that one can hear. But there are many, many people in this world who have not heard about Jesus, and they're living in a world of spiritual darkness. But Jesus, who said, "I am the light of the world," has given you and me an opportunity to share this good news of his love to others who have not heard about him. There are so many ministries that go about sharing God's love, and LLBN is one of them. We want to thank each one of you for being our faithful partners, for supporting us through your prayers and financial support. And as we are drawing to the end of this year, I'd like to appeal to each one of you. Consider LLBN in your year-end planning to give for God's cause. There's nothing better than sharing the love of Jesus with somebody who does not know God. After all, LLBN is all about lighting lives and blessing nations. Your participation can bring Jesus, the light of the world, to somebody and light up their lives. Thank you. God bless.
Mr. and Mrs. Miller had four children. Laura was 4 years old, Timmy was 6 years old, Peter was 10 years old, and Sharon was 14 years old. And little Laura bounded joyfully into the kitchen with her little piggy bank while Mama was doing dishes and said, "Mommy, my piggy bank is full enough. I want to give all of my money to the Bible missions so they could buy Bibles to give them to the people like this in the stories you read to us last night. Can you please count my pennies?" And so Mama took her little penny bank and emptied it out and fingered through there and counting 101, 102, 103. "Laura, you have $1.03. So we'll trade your 100 pennies and put $1 bill into an envelope and send it to the Bible mission so we can buy Bibles." And she asked excitedly, "How many Bibles can I buy with my $1? And Mama said, "Well, I don't know if you can buy a whole Bible with $1, but God will bless your dollar and it will surely grow." And Timmy was sitting at the table with his coloring book and while Mama was counting the pennies, and he went up to his room and opened up his money jar, and 4 quarters equals $1. "And I only have $1 bill that Grandpa just gave me, but if Laura can give $1, I can give 2. And Peter, who was reading his book, said, "What are you doing, Timmy?" "I'm sharing some money for Bibles to buy at the Bible mission." And Peter started thinking about the story Mama told last night, how this African village, people were dirty, they were mean, and they were poor, but somebody had brought home a Bible, and it changed that whole village. They cleaned up, they were hardworking, they read the Word of God, and it changed their lives, and they were happy and healthy because of that one Bible. And so he went to get in his room and opened up his drawer, got his wallet out, and he flipped through the wallet, and he had a $5 bill that he was saving for a chemistry set. But it could wait. The chemistry set can wait because Bibles are more important. And then as he's passing his sister Sharon in the hallway, she said, "What did you guys say about the Bible mission?" And he told them what they were planning to do, and she was excited, and "I want to help too." So she unzipped her purse, and she got out a $10 bill she had won as a prize for at school. And what could be more special than Bibles? "I'll give this $10. Meanwhile, downstairs, Mama was thinking, "Sweet little Laura, giving all of her money for Bibles for people who don't have them. If we adults did our part unselfishly as she did, then we could help her dollar grow too." And she pulled out her purse and got money out that she was saving for to buy for money for a dress. But she said, "You know, I can wait until next month." Well, everybody was really excited when Daddy came home and they showed him their envelope with the money in it for the Bible mission. And he said, "Well done. The Lord is pleased when we give so happily and unselfishly." And everybody went to bed that night and it was all quiet. And he sat at his desk and he pulled out his checkbook because he wanted to be able to give too. And he prayed, "Lord, thank you so much for little Laura, who inspired us all and gave us the example. And by the time I seal this envelope, her $1 bill will have grown to $100 to buy Bibles to send to the Bible mission." You know, it's hard to imagine that living here in America, there are still places in the world where people have no Bibles. Do you have a Bible at home? Do you have several? Are you spending time with your Bible every day getting to know Jesus? Do you want to help other people get to know Jesus? You can. Do you have dollars and coins that you can send to a Bible mission where they can send Bibles to people who have none but who need to hear about Jesus? If that's something that you want to do, let's pray and ask Jesus to help your dollars and coins grow. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for the children and the grown-up children who are listening and watching tonight. And Lord, please put it in our heart to be unselfish. There are so many people around the world who still have yet to hear about Jesus, and we can do our part. And I know that you'll bless our dollars and our coins to do great things for you. Please put more Bibles in the hands of people who are wistfully looking to heaven, waiting for the light that only you can give to them. And we thank you for hearing this prayer and for answering it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Dear friends and brothers and sisters, let's turn our eyes to the Word of God. Please turn your Bible with me to John chapter 2, verse 1 to 10. On the third day a wedding was gone. On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They had no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you to." Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." May God bless the reading of his word.
This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ, God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the plan of God was satisfied, for every sin by him was claimed. Here in the death of Christ, I live. There in the ground, his body lay. Light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry till final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns and calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns.
Well, what a nice song. Thank you, our two ladies dressed in purple, lavender, whatever that is. Anyway, it's lovely to have both of you. Paulette and I have been together, it feels like almost every day, for a month or 6 weeks. We were in South Philippines and then outside Manila, then we were in Palawan, and then we did Moreno Valley last week, and now we're here again tonight. So we're just a team. But Amanda, we haven't had for a while, so thank you for being here tonight. How are you all? I miss being here in a regular way. For a long time, I was here most of the time. But now, my other gig is being a global evangelist for Quiet Hour. We are now doing crusades around the world in person again. So I'm in and out, but it's coming where I will be here a little bit more here in the holidays and into the new year. But pray for me. I go to Vietnam on Sunday morning, and we're doing 2 weeks. Paulette is going also, and we're doing 4 days of evangelism in what they call now Ho Chi Minh City, the central church there. And then we're doing pastor's meetings and a church dedication. So just say a little prayer for our team. Some are already over there. I'm going to do a youth congress. They've asked me to come over next year in the Philippines, and we want to talk about some of the questions that young people have, and this is one of them. Tonight, I just wanted to start to think about these ideas. We go around the world, and we do evangelism, and we baptize. This is a wonderful lady that we just baptized in Palawan. If you look on the map of Philippines, a little long exclamation point. And just a great story, and we prayed for her. 1,062 people got baptized out in the ocean. Just a magic, magic day. But the question that some people are asking is, do we have any right to use the word best or better? Obviously, if we do evangelism, we're trying to have them come from something else that they believe to something that we believe and suggest is better. And there are those who say that we have no right to ever use the word best. You can say Jesus is best. You can say the Adventist church is the best. You can say the Sabbath is the best. You have no right to say any of that because we don't know for sure. It's always your own opinion. And we have no right to go around the world telling the world that what we have is the best or that we know the best. Best, better, good, greater, all these words are not appropriate. What do you think? Do we have the right to say that Michael Jordan is better than LeBron James? How do you decide that? How do you decide that one girl is prettier than another girl? And that's people's own choice. You like Oreo cookies, someone else likes macadamia nuts. There's no right or wrong, it's what you like, what's your taste. What you prefer. I like Thai, you like Indian. I like both. Who cares? Doesn't matter. You enjoy what you like. Everything is taste. Is that what religion is like? Do we have any right to say what is best. And people would say, for you to say that something is the best is arrogance. To go to another culture, to another country, to another group of people, and say, we have something for you that's better than what you already have. But I am just going to shout it out. I believe that Jesus is the best. Yes, it's true that we can't prove it. We can't prove that Jesus is God. We can't prove that one man's sin, one man's death died for everybody's sins. I can't prove there's a heaven. I can't prove that we're saved by Jesus alone. I can't prove any of that. And there are people who will say, it's just a blanket we've come up with to make us feel warm at night. That's all it is. We just made it up. But I'm going to try to deal with that tonight. I want to say, number one, there is a best. There is a best. Yes, there is a best. Paul said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. And then he says, I consider everything else worthless. So these things are worthless for the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus. Something was better than something else. Yes, it was. One man sold everything he had in order to get the pearl of great price. This was better than all of that. That's what it says. People have died for this gospel that Jesus is the best. 1,000 people got out in the water here 2 weeks ago to say that what they had heard is now better than what they had before. Thrilled to be baptized into Jesus. And so I believe, yes I do, that the Jesus is the best. And Jesus is the best picture of God. And the Adventist Church has the best picture of God. That the Adventist message is the closest to the Bible. And I am proud to go around the world and spread the gospel and have people join the church. I am not ashamed. And I tell people, you need to come out from those ideas about God and come to these. And I'm going to go to Vietnam this week. And in a very challenging place, I am going to do the best I can to lift up Jesus and say that I think Jesus is the best. You need Jesus. I heard a story by Joseph Stoll. He was speaking for graduation. He was the president of Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. And he told a story about a young girl who was about to graduate from Moody Bible. She was going to graduate. 3 weeks later, she was going to get married. And she and her new husband were going to go be missionaries for Jesus in Russia. And 3 weeks before, they're in a car and they get hit head-on by a truck and they die. And the parents were so distraught, they said to the pastor who did the funeral, how did God allow this? Our daughter's going to graduate, go be a missionary. And the pastor said, God didn't know about it. And they said to Dr. Stoll, is that what the answer is? And most of us would say, that cannot be the answer. And so we would say there are some answers that are better than others. There are some answers that are just wrong. Those are not adequate answers. And I am proud to say that some things I think we believe about God are better than that. We have a right to say something is the best. I'm going to bring back an old joke that we've used 1,000 times about the old couple flying from Edinburgh, Scotland, over to New York. They had never been on a plane before, but they're nervous, they're scared, but people took care of them, gave them blankets and pillows, they went to sleep. Halfway across the ocean, the captain shouts out over the intercom, I'm sorry to let you know, but one of our three engines is now broken. We had to turn it off, but don't be alarmed, we can make it on just two, but we will be now 2 hours late. A little while later, he goes again, he said, a second engine has now burst into flame. We had to turn that one off. But we can fly on just one, but now we will be 6 hours late. And the story goes is that over everybody talking, that old Scottish lady shouted into her husband's ear, if that last engine goes, we're going to be stuck up here all night. I don't know some things about that flight. I can't tell you which stewardess was prettier or how good the food was. But can we agree on this? One engine is better than no engine. Everyone agree with that. There are some ideas and some truths that are more true than other things. There are some things that are more easy to evaluate. You're not sure which basketball team is better, there's a score. That's a very definable number. You want to know who's taller? You measure, and you can tell who's taller. You want to know which car is faster? You have a race, and you see who is the best. But when you say, which color is more beautiful? That's a little harder. Which beach is the best? I was in Hawaii. I asked 17 people in my class. They gave all kinds of different answers. But can we just say there are just some things you know? And maybe it's difficult to really give you a logical answer, but I think most of us know mangoes are better than durian. Can we just agree on that? Can we agree that ice cream is better than broccoli? At least as far as whether you'd like to enjoy it eating or not. I'm sorry about this one. California is better than New Jersey. I'm sorry, New Jersey always gets the jokes. I'm sure it's a beautiful place. Those of us who follow Michael Jordan and the Chicago Bulls from 30 years ago will say they are better than the Golden State Warriors with Steph Curry. Who says, well, we've got 6 world championships, they've got 4. How do you measure these things? I'd rather watch sports on television than to go out and do yard work. We just have an instinctive sense that some things are better than some other things. But sometimes we can do logic, how things fit together. We could probably make a pretty good case why 2 plus 2 equals 4 is better than 2 plus 2 is 5. We probably could make that case. You just measure odds. If you see a car, which would be more likely? Which would be the better answer? That car just popped out of nothing on a road one day, or that somebody smart made it? And most of us would say, based on our life history and the odds of what we know and have experienced, we've never seen anything just pop into being. We've seen a lot of things made by smart people. We think someone smart made that. It's logical. It hangs together. It answers more questions. We just would all probably agree. Julia Roberts is better looking and prettier than that. Maybe most of us would rather go to the beach than the desert. We'd rather have a day with beautiful blue sky than to be in a day with blowing snow in your face all the time. There are just some things that we instinctively know, and we say, it's not wrong to say that these things are better. We know it. We know it. God created Adam and Eve. So we go back to creation. There are some things he said that were good, but when he got to Adam and Eve and man, he said, that's very good. God himself is saying, this is better than that. Every day of creation was better than the day before it. So God made these animals are better than those animals, and then man is better than the monkeys, and then woman was the last one better than... I'll be careful. Yeah, we heard the old joke, when God saw he made man, he said, I can do better than that, and then he made woman. Old joke. And then he created the Sabbath. But here we have God making his own statement that some things are better than others. And it's all the way through the Bible. You go to Noah's Ark. Can we agree that being inside the boat was better than being outside the boat? You can't just say, I don't think it really matters if you're inside the boat or you're outside having a party. When the rain began to fall, it made a difference, and one was better than the other. The options are not all equal. This is not just Oreos or macadamia nuts. This is your life. One is better than another. When Lot's wife, God said to them, don't look back. Just don't look back. What he's going to do to Sodom and Gomorrah. She looks back. She was saying that where I came from is better than where I'm going. God says, no, don't look back. Wherever God has taken you is always better than wherever you were before. That's what God does. Some things are better. Don't look back. So I don't think we have to be ashamed of saying something is better than another. But of course, the most important story, the best story, would be the story of changing the water into wine. Jesus is invited to the wedding. The wine runs out. Mary tells them, do whatever Jesus tells you to do. They pour it with water, and Jesus does the magic and changes the water to wine. You know the story. But then, on the way out the door, they say, you have saved the best for last. Most people bring one kind of wine, and then they give the cheap wine when they're drunk. You have saved the best for last. Clearly, he is saying, Jesus is the best. Jesus is the best. The cross is the best. Salvation in Jesus is the best. Jesus is the best God. Jesus is the best picture of God. Being saved by Jesus is better than trying to be saved by yourself. Jesus is the best. That's his first story. You have saved the best for last. Jesus is the best. Jesus is the best. Love is better than hate. Heaven is better than hell. Let's not apologize for saying that something is best. It's all the way through the Bible. You look at the world religions, we have a lot to respect about all of them. But all the leaders of all the other world religions are dead. There's only one who's alive. I choose Jesus, the one who's alive, who rose from the grave. Jesus said he was God. You think about the other religions, the Buddha said there is no God. You don't need to have a God. Hinduism said that there are 300,000 gods. Jesus is just one of those. The Jews say he hasn't even come yet. We're still waiting for him. Muslims will say, we have a prophet. But out of all those choices, if you want to know what God is like, I choose Christianity because in Christianity, Jesus is God himself. He's not coming to tell us about God. He shows us God. I think that's the best. I choose Christianity. Jesus is the best. I think we can make sense of that. Can we go a little farther now? I think you can make the case from this story that the last group will be the best. That's what Jesus says, the best for last. You think about the story of the Good Samaritan. Here came the priest, goes on by. Here comes the Levite, walks on by. The Good Samaritan stops and takes care of him. If the Good Samaritan is Jesus, I think we can make that case. Who was there at the end of the story? It is not the good people, the religious people, the people who keep all the rules, the people who think they're the best. They walked on by. They're no longer there where the Good Samaritan is taking care of this person. That's where Jesus is. Jesus is the one taking care of people. They're not there anymore. They've gone over the hill. Can we be clear about this? There are the people who are the Pharisees, who are the finger pointers. They are the criticizers. They are the ones who judge. They are absolutely sure that they are the best, that they are the closest to God, that they have the truth, and that they will be the ones who will have the last message to go over the line. No. No, this story says they will not. They go over the hill. They're gone. They're not there at the end of the story. They're going to be gone. They're going to shake out. If the hotel where the Good Samaritan took that man who had been beaten up is the final church at the end of the world, there's only the Good Samaritan and the one who was robbed. All the good people, the Pharisees and the finger pointers and the judges and the criticizers, they're all gone. They've gone over the hill. Everything turns upside down in the shaking. The people who are in are the one who was robbed and the people who are the Good Samaritans. The people who are out are the Pharisees and the Levites and the priests. They're gone, the good people. It's going to be surprising who was there at the end of the world. When they brought the lady caught in adultery to Jesus, they were sure they were in the right. They caught this lady. She's the one that's wrong. They are in the right. They are the closest to God. They will be the righteous ones that God will save. Jesus writes their sins in the sand, and when they see them, they're all gone. They are not with Jesus anymore. The only people who will be there at the end are the sinners who come to Jesus and Jesus, the good people are all gone. There's going to be a group of people at the end of the world who are going to be all good Samaritans. Can we go on with this a little bit? The good Samaritan pays for everything. He goes the first time when he takes the man to the inn. He pays for everything. And then he says, if there's any more bill when I come back, I'll take care of that too. The robber has nothing. He's lost everything. It is the Good Samaritan who pays it all. Can we hear the truth in this story that Jesus pays it all? He is there at the beginning, at the end. He is the Alpha and the Omega. You don't start with by yourself and then finish with Jesus. You don't start with Jesus and end on your own. It is Jesus who pays it all, every single penny. You and I can't pay any of it. It's all Jesus and the Good Samaritan. These are good people. These are good people. But at the end of the world, they will be part of the grand group in the on the white horses. That's a group of people going to be here at the end. I'm going to say this group of people who are at the end, they are good people, but they are primarily good Samaritans. They are not just the priests and the Levites who are good, but they walk on by. The group of people who are going to be that last group of people, the remnant people at the end of the world, they are going to be good Samaritans. They are the ones who are always kind. They are the ones who always stop. They don't care what color you have, where you come from, what your language is, what sins you've committed. They don't care your nationality. They don't care about any of that. They're just good Samaritans. Those will be the people at the end. Can you imagine what it will be like to be just people like that? All the finger pointers are gone. The judges are gone. The Pharisees are gone. The priests and the Levites have gone over the hill. The only people here at the end are the good people, the kind people, the good Samaritan people who stop, who will never go by. They will stop. I had to get a shot today, an hour ago. And when I got there, I was delayed from being in jury trial. I got to the hospital, I got to my unit, and it was closed. The doors were locked. And I went outside. I could not get back in. I had to come here. I know what to do. I went and knocked on a door. Why would they come and let me in? But they did. I said, I'm so sorry, but I need a shot. I'm going to Vietnam. I have. And she said, come on in. They stopped for me. That's the kind of people that will be here at the end of the world. Someday the church will only be made up of good Samaritans. God is saving the best for the last. And now I want to go one more step before we're done. The last message will be the best. They said, you have saved the best for last. It's really tempting for people to begin to think that they have the truth. People say they have the truth. Maybe you think you've kind of got the truth now, that you have got all the truth there is to have, and you are the best version. You know it. You've hammered it out, and you know the truth. That's the choice, Wayne. There are those who think that it's the pioneers who had the best. That if we could just go back to that age, there was the golden age when they hammered out the truth and they had the best, that we have lost our way. We have to go back to some golden era where people had the best. And I honor the pioneers. But in this story, Jesus says you start with a choice, but God is saving the best for last. We don't have the best yet. I'm going to say to that 20,000 group of young people at the Youth Congress over there, we are counting on you. We are counting on you to take it to the next level. There's one more level God is expecting us to get to. He will change the water to wine one last time, and the best will be the last message that will be given to the world. I am not afraid to say that something is the best. You take a subject like heaven. When we talk about heaven, we have nirvana. People don't even know exactly what it is. It's just a mist. It's just an unknown. Other people will say we're going to be like spirits. Not even real world anymore. Christianity says, no, it's going to be real. You can put your hands on it. It's going to be like the Iceland. It's going to be gorgeous and waterfalls and mountains and beauty. It's real. It's real. It's going to be fantastic. It's going to be better. We can say that some things are better. It's going to be better than Iceland. It's going to be better than Disneyland. It's going to be the best. If I had to choose between all of that, some people say it's going to be like spirits. How will I even know which one is my father? I just know he's here somewhere, but they all look alike. No. I want a place that's real, where we recognize each other, where it's tangible and it's better. It's like this life, only better. I choose our view. It's the best. I'm not ashamed. I'm proud of that. You can decide how you were saved. One view is to do it by what you do. You've got to light some candles. You've got to go to Mecca. You have to do something. Or you can say, I don't think it's based upon what you do. It's what Jesus has already done. I think that's better. I think that's better. There are a lot of people think that when you sin against God, it makes God a little bit mad. When he sees you swear, or he sees you break a Sabbath or whatever, he gets mad. And he has angels writing all that down. He's going to keep track of this. And he is storing up his wrath about that, and he's going to get even someday. And finally, there's going to be a day when God gets mad, and he is going to throw everybody that has accumulated those sins into a huge burning lake of fire. Is that as good as we can do? Is it wrong for us to say we don't think God is like that? We don't think that's who God is. We think there is a better picture of God than that. Can we just say that we think what happens that God says, if you eat of the tree, you will surely die. Please don't leave. But if people turn around and say, God, we don't want you. We don't need you. We don't need your church. We don't need your religion. We don't need any of it. God lets people go and they walk out the door. And when they walk out that door, there is nothing of God out there. That whatever's out there is not from God, is not caused by God, does not do it. It is what people do themselves. It's their own reality. And if they can find some source of life out there besides God, bless you. Don't think you will. But I think that view is better than God getting mad and hurling people into an eternally burning lake of fire. I am never going to apologize for saying one is better than another. Some people think you don't need a church. You can say, I'm spiritual but not religious. I think I can make it on my own. You can have your own life, walk with God. You can be spiritual at home. You can do this all at home. I'm glad if you're at home watching tonight. Thank you very much. But I believe we need a church. God created a church family. He says, I will build my church. Don't forsake the church. A group of people who get together to worship God and do music. We had amazing worship times over there in the Philippines together. You have to do that together. You can't do that all by yourself. Whenever there's a disaster around the world, it's a church that goes. I just think being part of a church is better than not being part of a church. I think the Sabbath, I think keeping the original Sabbath that God set with his own finger thousands of years ago is better than taking a copy that people made 300 years after Christ was here. I think waiting to get married, waiting until someone stands up in front of everybody and says, I promise to be faithful to you forever, is better than just moving in with someone and saying, where do you want me to put my stuff? I think drinking smoothies and cranberry juice is better than drinking a drug and alcohol. I just think some things are better. You will have to decide. But I will die for this, that it is not arrogance to say that some things are better. God says to have no other gods before me. And God is better. Jesus is better. I believe the Adventist package of truth is better. And I go around the world and I'm proud and stand in front of a crowd and say, I hope you'll like this picture of God is better than what they already have. And they stand and they go out into the water and they get baptized. I need to come to an end here. One last story. We were in Jordan years ago. We were in Petra, one of the great spots of the world. These great temples have been carved out of the rock. But they talk about the high places. You go up these steps to get up to the high place. 1,000 steps with no railing. It was about sundown, and my friend and I were taking pictures and took too long. By the time we got to the top, we couldn't find a group, and we couldn't see where anyone was. And then it got dark, and there was no moon, there was no light, there was no street light, there was nothing. I thought, no problem, I got a flashlight. I clicked it on, nothing. I put new batteries in, nothing. Turned out the bulb was gone. So we're in trouble. We have 1,000 steps to go down in absolutely pitch black darkness. I said to myself, I'm not going to die tonight on this place. I decided I was going to go backwards and I was going to feel it for every step. If you miss a step, it was 1,000 feet to the bottom. So I'm going to feel if there's no step, then I know I got to go left or right. I'm not. It takes me all night. I am not going to die tonight on these steps. We began to slowly go down when all of a sudden there was someone with a little flash, with a cell phone. Our whole group, they were all there together holding hands. One person had one light. We said, wait, guys, wait until we catch up to you. And then we all held hands and we went with that one light. Can I just gently say, having that light was better than not having a light. Having that light was better than being in the darkness. Jesus is that light. And we go all over the world and we are an LLBN because we believe that we have something to give to the world that is better than what people already have. And we baptized 1,000 people in the ocean 3 weeks ago. And I am proud and I absolutely believe that what they have and what they heard is better than what they had heard before. The picture of God and of Jesus. We are not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the best. God bless you. We have a song for you.
Thank you, Lord, for being our light. This dark, dark world. You truly are worthy of all of our praise. You truly are worthy of a full day of worship. We pray that you bless us as we sing this song.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid. Bearing all my sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing.
Seated on the throne.
darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
I can tell a story on Paulette. We were over in Southern Philippines, and we've done this before, but not with her. Is that we teach the kids how to do Worthy is the Lamb with sign language. And Paulette watched videos one night, and she had it the next night, and began to invite a few kids and showed them how to do it. And a few kids became more and became more. I was looking at a picture last night. The last day when we had everyone there, the stage was full of kids. Then she did it again over in the next island. By the end again, when we had 3,000 people in the stadium, we had this just mob of kids on the stage and many other adults. Then she made a video for us to do it in Moreno Valley last week. Why do we do it? Why does she go? Why do we get on a plane and fly around the world? Why does LLBN exist? At the rock bottom of this, we believe that knowing God is better than not knowing God. Having Jesus as your Savior is better than not having Jesus as your Savior. Having a day as a Sabbath in your life is better than not having a Sabbath. We, at the core of the evangelistic effort, is the idea that something is better than something else. And we believe this is the best. And we stand before God and say, this is the best. We share that with the world. I hope that makes sense to you. Thanks for being with us. This is LLBN. We'll see you next week.